chosen.
I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am.
Thank you, Father.
You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am.
I am.
Father, we give thanks to you, for you have adopted us as your sons through Jesus. Oh Lord, what a blessed position it is to stand here, not as slaves, but free as sons, as your children. We thank you, Lord, for your goodness.
Me all my days, I've been
day, as we celebrate Father's Day, we remember your goodness. We give thanks to you, Father, for you are good, you are faithful. You are our Heavenly Father, who has redeemed us, ransomed us, saved us from the kingdom of darkness, the kingdom of death, through Jesus, that we have been adopted as sons. Through Jesus, that we have received your Spirit, the indwelling of your presence in our life. Through Jesus, that we have received life in its fullness. Through Jesus, that we have received your love in its fullness. Through Jesus, Lord, we thank you because you have given us the greatest gift that all of us could desire. That is Jesus. We thank you as we remember Father's Day today. We thank you, Lord, for your gift of life that is poured out to all of us who believe in Jesus. We thank you, Lord, for all that you have given to us and all that you've done. We give you all glory, all honor, all praise. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Brothers and sisters, please be seated. Once again, a very good morning to all of you who are joining us here in Desert Stream. And happy Father's Day to all the fathers. And right now, I'd like to pass the time to Reverend Roy, who will be sharing the word with us.
Check one, sir. Very good morning. What a wonderful day to start today. I'm not sure for the children or the wives or grandchildren, have you hugged your grandfather or father today? Give them a kiss. Still kiss, ah? Still, ah? Give them at least wish them a happy Father's Day. Together with me today, I'm going to look in the Bible or the text on fatherhood of God. Say together, fatherhood of God. Say together, fatherhood of God. So even before we talk about fathers, the idea of a fatherhood or being a father or being the head of the family already begin before us, before our time. And that itself already begin with God. And today we celebrate the greatness of the goodness of a father because we have something to refer on. We have something to, someone to refer to. We have a God that we can model or we can follow an example being a father. And the story in the Bible tell us not just God who saved his people, but also God who showed himself as a figure of a father. In the Bible, interestingly, in the Old Testament, the word father only mentioned 15 times. But right after that, in the New Testament, it mentioned 165 times or more. So the portrayal is surprising in the Old Testament, but at the same time, it is a picture that carries on when we reach to the New Testament. Example, in the book of Isaiah 63, he says, 63 verse 16, he said, "But you are our father to Abraham though Abraham does not know us or Israel acknowledge us, you, Lord, are our Father, our Redeemer. From old is your name. And then it carries on in the book of Jeremiah, the book of Malachi. If you can still remember, I managed to bring out a little bit of the book of Malachi, where we talk about how the end time going to the God's end time strategy of restoration, where he said what? The hearts of the father will be turned to the children, the children to the father. And of course, God also showed himself the figure of a father to certain individual in 2 Samuel, where when the Bible says 2 Samuel 7:14, he said he is the father to David's offspring, that God will be his father and he will be my son, which is Solomon. Occurred when David had a heart to build God's house. And of course, carries on in many references in the Old Testament. Now, the teaching of fatherhood of God make a turn when it come to the New Testament, when it talk about Jesus. But of course, we will see not every part today, because we only have 45 minutes or less than that to talk about the whole scripture of the fatherhood of God. But I will bring up quite a number today. I think it's about 5. And what we're going to see is basically what really repeated quite a number of times, and I hope can help you or every one of us as we begin to see the picture of a father in your life. How would you appreciate it? And in fact, how would that improve? How will it make my relationship with God much better? Are you ready? Now, because if I can say to you a little bit more. Now, Jesus also used the metaphor of a father, and it's not surprisingly, the New Testament also emphasized on the work of fatherhood. And later after that, Paul also wrote, in fact, described father, the Bible scholars counted it for me, 40 times. And it occurs in the blessing, what else? Doxologies, thanksgiving, in prayer, exhortation, and even the creed. So all this Paul based, the fatherhood is based not so much on God's role, but rather on the redemption, on reconciling that God has made available in Jesus. So meaning through Jesus, then we know the Father. Through Jesus, then you can call him Father. So that's a very important thing to begin. Now we're going to look into some characteristics of fatherhood of God in the Bible, and I hope it will help you. One of the first reference in the Bible that God identify himself as a figure of a father is not so much when he say, I am a father. He says that in Exodus 4:22-23, if you have your Bible or in the screen, the Bible says to Moses what to say to Pharaoh. Then he said, you shall say to Pharaoh, thus says the Lord, Israel is my son, my firstborn. So I say to you, let my son go, so that he may serve me. But if you refuse to let him go, I will kill your son, your firstborn. Macam jahat lah. Bukan Moses say, God himself said this to Moses. I don't know about you, but somehow this is one of the first picture of how God see his people as a children. And the first group of people that God called them my children is Israel. Now, a father care for his children. What happens to your children, a father feels something. Betul ka? Do you just let your children hurt like that? No, you feel something when your child hurt. what happened to Israel, God take it seriously. He says, Israel, it's my son. In fact, God gave Israel a special position, not just a son, but a firstborn. Not second, third, or fourth, firstborn. They are a people that related to him. They are the people that have close relationship with him. These people are not just a creation. They are not a distant group. They are close with God. In this text, in other words, God says, you better let my children go or else. Or me as a father will do something to you. You harm my child, I will harm you. Imagine your child kena bully. Will you just keep quiet? No, bakan. I just told my son today, can I share the story, what happened to you? And he said, okay lah. There was one time in sekolah rendah, he went back to school. We saw some blood over his lips. So you know lah. It's either kamu tergigit, you bite your what, or something else hurt you lah. Why is it like that? At first he reluctant to say. So he was skeptical. Hey, what happened? What happened at school? And finally he told me, oh kawan, ada main-main ba? Wah, main-main? Main apa dia? What did they play? So he got a friend. Of course, he's a good friend. I met him and he came to my place when they do a practice, when they do a presentation as a band. So they came to our place. But he's good in Muay Thai. That guy, young boy, but he was trained as a Muay Thai. Now I think Taekwondo, is it? Taekwondo. So my son, not yet. So anyone here teach Muay Thai? So he was like, they said they're playing around, but you know, like when you play, your thing come out, but you know, your what you learn in the gym or what come out, you know, somehow I don't know what happened. Maybe they play around, and poof, wow, darah, got blood here. So I don't know, but the first instance as a parent, right? How come, huh? Because we don't know the story behind my kids play around my gun, but as a father, we don't know what's happened to our child. Maybe he hurt. Maybe maybe he purposely do that. Maybe guess what? Kena bully. That's our first instance. Kena bully. So we ask, "Kau kena bully ka?" And I ask a lot of questions. Tanya dia, no, he's just playing around. He's just playing around. But then I even thinking, maybe I should teach him how to defend. Teach him a little bit of kung fu, but I don't know anything. I don't know. If I teach him also, maybe masih kena juga tu. You know, it's not correct. I don't know anything. But there you go. When you know that someone is bullying, someone is threatening a child, your child, there will be a lot of things going on your mind, whether should I do anything? Should I respond? But it's the father love Israel so much until he give a standard. You kill my son, I will kill yours. Macam you take something from me, I will give you something. Anyway, there's a better explanation here. It's not from me, so I take it from an article. His name is Goran Medvedevsky. Okay. He said, so God tell Moses ahead of time what will happen. Meaning what will happen when he will meet Pharaoh. And revealing himself, God revealing himself as a father to the Israelite and the people as his son. We can make reasonable conclusion here as why God consider himself as the father of Israel. He called Abraham in order to make the nation of Israel out of his descendants. Who is Israel? Jacob. Then he let Jacob the family of Jacob to Egypt with the intention to multiply them and to make them into a nation one day. And then in that way, God will exhibit the fatherly characteristic by being a caretaker for the Israelite people. That's why I put the first point. The father, the figure of a father to us, to his people, first will be a father that care. I care. Yes, I can let you go, but I care what happened to you. The purpose of all God's dealing with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob was to make Israel to form a people for God himself. Furthermore, the expression of firstborn was very special because it draws them that into association in our minds, such as when you have firstborn, what do you enjoy when you're firstborn? Birthright. Okay? Amen? If you are firstborn, don't play. Oh. Anyone here firstborn? Special. You're number one. You anything happen in the family, you enjoy the blessing. My first son, and then God say what? My firstborn. It draws certain association in our minds that this implying that God has an inheritance for Israel, for his son. That's how close, that's the first few things that the Bible tells us of the fatherhood of God. Tell your friend next to you, you have an inheritance. Our brother Leonard just now is saying a very good Bible text reference a very good Bible text that you are adopted. Okay? Amen. That's a good picture of who you are now and who you were before. Adopted means you were not in the family before. But because you are adopted, you are part. You have the right. You have an inheritance. You have the authority. You have, you are being included in a big family of God. Number two, a fatherhood of God, also we can see in the Bible as mentioned as a father to the fatherless. Say it together, a father to the fatherless. Psalms recorded it in 68, Psalm 68, 4-7. Sing to God, sing praise to his name, extol him who rides on the clouds. His name is the Lord, and rejoice before him. A father to the fatherless, a defender of widows, in God, in his holy dwelling. God sets the lonely in families. He leads forth the prisoner with singing, but the rebellious life in a sun-scorched land. When you went out before your people, O God, when you marched through the wasteland. So a child may have a situation where they will lose a father. I feel something last Friday, went to a friend's place. Pastor Margaret led us to a friend's place in hospital where a family just lost a father. Oh, that's a very sad thing when you know that a child will lose a father, in whatever reason. Maybe death, maybe divorce, or whatever the case it may be. But when they go through that period of no more father in the family, we call it fatherless. There's a child, there's a widow without a father, without a head, like a body without a head. A sense of loss of protection, a sense of loss of provision. No one is going to bless them. No one is going to guide them. No one is going to teach them. In fact, we are not surprised today. Many of our problems in our world comes from people who do not have fathers. To be a father to the fatherless is not just a position, my friends. It's not a very easy place to replace. It's a lifetime commitment. It's a personal decision. So when God says, I'm going to be a father to the fatherless, well, he's taking over a position, a lifetime commitment, a personal decision. When God taking the position of a father, now the child, the widow, can plead, can be teach, can guide. They have a place, a person to go to. They can pray, they can worship, they can ask. They are protected. They have people who can guide them. So they have a place to go to. I like what John says, John 14, 15 to 21. The Bible says, if you love me, you will obey my command. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another counselor to be with you forever, the Spirit of truth. The world cannot accept him because it neither sees him nor knows him. But you know him, for he lives with you and will be in you. Verse 18 is important. I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. Before long, the world will not see me anymore, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. On that day, you will realize that I am in my Father, and you are in me, and I am in you. Whoever has my commands and obey them, he is the one who loves me. He who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I too will love him and show myself to him. This is was an exchange of Jesus with the disciples, right? Before, was it Philip asked a question, show us the Father. Show us the Father. You asked us to call him Abba Father. Now, show us the Father. And this is the explanation of Jesus. If you love me, you know my command, and you will see the Father through me. But I like verse 18. He said, I will not leave you as orphans. As this was an indicator where God will leave them eventually. God will leave the disciples. They will be separated. You know lah, bila bapa sudah tidak ada, get what happened to the widow or to the child. They feel that they lost sense of guidance. They lost the sense of fatherless. But this is what our Heavenly Father said to you. I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. Why? Because he said, I'm going to send you someone and he will be your guide. He says, it is the Spirit of truth. Amen. Today you have the Spirit of truth. In all our daily life, we need the Spirit of truth. Those who came to our prayer and altar and prayers equipping course, very encouraged. I'm very encouraged by what Bishop told us about altars and how relationship with God, and today we can connect with God, we can reach out to God. And the best thing is this, we have the Holy Spirit. You are not left like, biarlah dia punya, let him decide what he wants to do. No, there's a Spirit. I will not leave you as orphans. There's someone who can guide you, there's someone you can plead to. There's someone you can pray to. There's someone you can hope to. Even you think that even your family or even your people surround you, you feel that, they all don't like me. They all reject me. No, we have a Father that will not leave you as orphans. Isaiah also mentioned that in Isaiah 43, he said, I will say to the north, give them up, and to the south, do not give them back. Do not keep them back. Bring my sons from afar and my daughters from the ends of the earth. Everyone who is called by my name, whom I created for my glory, I formed him. Yes, I have made him. Tell your friend next to you, you are sons and you are daughters. Amazing. Amazing. God specifically tell us we have this position of closeness, of intimacy with God when he calls us sons and daughters. So God cared, God concerned about what you and I are doing every day. God also showed to us that he will not leave you just because we are distant, just because we feel that God is not here physically. Doesn't mean that we are fatherless. No, I will not leave you. But this is what the father do also. Don't forget. Number three, a father disciplines his children. When was the last time you disciplined a child? I would like to read to you what the Bible says in Hebrew. Or maybe Proverbs first. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 11 to 12. He said, my son, do not despise the Lord's discipline and do not resent his rebuke, because the Lord disciplines those he loves. As a father, the son he delights in. And then Hebrew reminds the Jews at the time, in Hebrews 12, 5 to 11, mentioned the same one mentioned in the Proverbs. Okay, let's read together. Okay, I like this, because once you read this, it's almost as a preaching. You can go home. One, two, go. And you have forgotten the word of encouragement that addresses you as sons. My son, do not make light of the Lord's discipline, and do not lose heart when he rebukes you. Because the Lord's discipline, those he loves, and he punishes everyone he accepts as a son. Endure hardship as a discipline. God is treating you as sons. For what son is not disciplined by his father? If you are not disciplined, and everyone undergoes discipline, then you are illegitimate children and not true sons. Moreover, we all had human fathers who disciplined us, and we respect them for it. How much more should we submit to the Father of our spirits and live? Verse 10, our fathers disciplined us for a little while as they thought best, but God disciplined us for good, that we may share in his holiness. No discipline seemed pleasant at the time, but painful. Later on, however, he produced a harvest, righteousness, and peace for those who have been trained in it. See, preaching already. I need to preach. It's interesting how discipline now become an essential part of a father. But of course, we know now, of course, even right now also we know why your father disciplined you. Why your father asks you to go to church every morning you don't like. Why your father asks you to be a man. Why your father asks you to lead. Why your father asks you to do this and do that. When a father discipline, I like the Bible says in verse 10, it is not just for the best, but it is for your good. And I like what he continues. So that we may share in his holiness. Now God has something for you. And when he wanted to hand it over to you, he will make sure that you can handle it. That's why some of our prayers God doesn't give lah. Ngam kan? Like your son asks, Pap, can I have a Gillette? Gillette, shaver. Can I have it? Your father say what? No. And he will continue, not now. Nantilah, bila ada sudah mustache or janggut, then I give you. Right? So, It disciplines us for our good, that we may share in His holiness. Holiness of God. It is something God has given and prepared for His sons. And to stay in this holiness, it requires discipline. My son, he said, do not despise the Lord's discipline. Almost every day, we despise discipline. We have our own thinking of, oh, my way is the best way, or I don't think my father understands what I'm going through. Yeah. He's losing it, you know. But no, a father knows what is good because he has something to share with you one day. I have to go fast because I have 5 points. So, number four. A fatherhood of God is also a father who gives good gifts. Say together, good gifts. Okay, let me remind again. What's number one just now?
Father care.
Yes, father care, father concern in a way. Number two? He's a father to a fatherless. Just because we are distant with God does not mean God leave us. Number three, just now? Disciplines his children. And number three, a father give good gifts. It continues on when he said, I discipline you for your good. I like what the Bible says in Matthew 7:7-12. Ask and it will be given you. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks, receive. He who seeks, find. And to him who knocks, the door will be opened. Which of you, if his son asks for bread, will give him a stone? Angkat tangan. Pak, beli dulu itu roti gardenia, you buy stone. No, they want a bread, okay? Or if he asks a fish, you give him a snake. If you then, though you are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give good gifts to those who seek him? So in everything to do to others what you would have them to do to you. This sums up the law and the prophets. So following up this now, when God gives discipline us, is for our good. And what are the things that happens after discipline? The good gifts come. God gave the best to his children. We are evil, but God is good. Ngamkan? But then, if we are evil, though we are evil, still know how to give good gifts. What do you think? God, who is good, how much good do you think he will give to us? A lot more good than what we think. A lot, much, much better than we think. 100% the best comes from God. What I think best, maybe 50%, maybe 60%. But what God thinks is 100% is complete, is the best. As much as we think that we are giving our best, God can always give a better one. God can always give the best. So when you pray, when you give intercede, or when you ask something from God, this is what a father do. He will never reluctant. We are never pray to a reluctant father. And he has the wisdom. Some things that we may ask may not be the one that you wanted. But God knows, because it is not the best. So based on what? Based on his wisdom, what you and I are asking is not the best. So even in the worst time, God is still good. He never gives a stone when someone asks for bread, for his child asks for bread. Now, what happened here is this. When this happens, there are Something happened between you and God, which is the intimacy and strong bondage. You receive a reward every time you ask from a father. The same book, Matthew, before this chapter 7, right, was a series of teaching of Jesus of on prayer and giving and also on fasting. So I like to draw attention to you what similarities that interested me when I read some commentaries and some people who preach about this. There are similarities when God says, even before he said, now ask whatever you want, I will give to you. I will give to you. But before that, right, even greater things happen actually if you read Matthew chapter 6. Matthew chapter 6 verse 4. He said, when you... let me read you Matthew chapter 6 verse 4 first. So that your giving may be in secret. Then your Father who see what is done in secret will reward you. Matthew chapter 6 verse 6. But when you pray, go into your room, close the door, and pray to your Father who is unseen. Then your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. Matthew 6:18. So that it will not be obvious to men that when you are fasting, but only to your Father who is unseen, and your Father who done that in secret will reward you. It's amazing how whenever that we begin to have that closeness relationship with God, whatever you've done, we don't need to publicize. You don't need to tell everyone, oh, I've done this, I prayed, I fast, I give. He said, when you pray, do it in secret. Then your Father in heaven will reward you. When you fast in secret. But your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. Somehow in giving and prayer, when done in secret, it gives us a very assurance that the Father is ready to bless you, is ready to reward you. Now, I don't know about you, but my first blessing from my Father is a bicycle. I think I told you before, or maybe I don't. And I never thought I'm going to get it because all my cousins in my home place, semua ada basikal. They have BMX lah. Last time was mountain bike, famous mountain bike. You know, that time, during our time, when you have a bicycle that has gear, you are very blessed. That time. Because the normal bicycle will be one gear. One gear means no gear lah. Means satu saja. There's only one. Or you have multiple gear, what? You can show off. You can show off. Hey, you can show off to your friend, ma. So, I don't even have a bike, but I remember I pray to the Heavenly Father because I was in the Sunday school or in the, they teach us, oh, you ask, and then you the Lord will give you. I ask, Lord. My Sunday school teacher asked me to ask, ma. I ask, lah. Let me ask, oh, Lord, help me. Betul-betul. On my birthday, I wake up in the morning. My mom was washing dishes. So I came, I got, and then I saw, because our house is just on the ground. Memang house on the ground, bukan? Maksudnya bukan tingkat-tingkat, ba. Sorry, ya. You guys tingkat-tingkat, bukan? You guys stay in 4th, 5th floor, right? But I was ground, ya. Yeah. And then got the fence there, and I saw a bike. I was like, Mom, siapa punya bike tu? Look nice. Red color. Still remember. Not even, not even the original, what lah, but it's a bike lah. It's a bike, rather new. When it was raining heavily, basah, so, kasih masuk ini basikal. Okay lah, saya akan masuk.
Oh, very nice. Oh. Siapa punya nih?
Ya, mamam sih. Kau punyalah. It's yours. Hah? And I check. Wah, got brake, nice. The seat also nice. And ada gear. When I know it's ada gear, I know the Lord answer my prayer. If no gear, then I will ask God, God, you forget. But God gear means God don't forget. I don't know about you, but I never tell my mom. I never tell my dad. I tell Heavenly Father. I want a bike. I don't know why. Maybe my mother or father see me. Kesian siro, tengok-tengok orang main basikal. Go see other the cousins go play basikal. I have to borrow, you know. I have to borrow, then I can go up and play. Not even a very straight patu. The road in my house is not even a only rocks batu. So I have to cycle very hard. But I like it. I see the picture of because I asked my mom who bought this. Bapak mula, your father. The father sees when you ask of him. Even you try to hide, right? The father knows. Try lah to hide something from your dad. I think he knows already. Try to hide some of the things that you did, right, in school. By the time you go home, quiet, what happened? They will know. Try to make decisions without them knowing. They know that you already make the wrong decision or the right decision. So knowing this, right, even our earthly fathers know how to give good gifts. There are things that in your mind now that you have not prayed, right? Our Heavenly Father knows already. He knows it. Probably the few things that hinder, maybe what the bishop told us, maybe the altar not yet set up. But if you don't want to know more, come next time. But other than that, God knows already. He knows what you really want. And it's the best one. Better than our earthly fathers. God knows. Even when you pray in secret, even when you fast in secret, when you give in secret, get ready. The Father will also reward you. Even before you even realize it is going to come true in your life. But the question is this: why are we neglecting such things in our life that we replace this relationship with the Father with something else? Why are we replacing that heavenly relationship that God has built to His children, that we are His children, and we replace it with something else? The short answer will be this. The evil one has many ways to deviate you and I to the fatherhood of God. He wants to show to us, no la, your father doesn't love you la. I don't think God that big can listen. What kind of request are you asking or is nonsense? Let me show you a better way to show you, and I will show you how to get what you want. There's an easier way. Not Heavenly Father lah. He wants to deviate us from the fatherhood of God. The Bible says God knows even before we ask Him. He knows the hidden things. So what are the hidden things that you are asking God right now? Even before you say, God knows. But of course, still say it lah. Still ask Him. Continue to ask Him. God, the Heavenly Father, who sees what is done in secret, will reward you. And last but not least, a father shows compassion to his children. Psalms 103, the Bible says, verse 1, Ode of David, praise the Lord, O my soul, all my inmost being, praise his holy name. Praise the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgives all sins and heals all diseases, who redeems your life from the pit and crowns you with love and compassion, who satisfies your desires with good things, so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. The Lord's work is righteousness and justice for all the oppressed. He made known his ways to Moses, his deeds to the people of Israel. The Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love. He will not always accuse, nor will he harbor his anger forever. He does not treat us as our sins deserve or repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens above the earth, so great is his love for those who fear him. As far as the east from the west, so far he has removed transgressions from us. As a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him. For he knows how he formed. He remembers that we are thus. One big characteristic of fatherhood of God is that he has compassion. Now, this compassion described by the psalmist in a wonderful way, when he says he is compassionate, gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love. He will not always accuse, nor will he harbor his anger forever. Amen. He said he treats us our sins. He does not treat us as our sins deserve or repay us according to our iniquities. If God wants to repay you according to what wrongdoings that we do, then susah lah. Everything wrong, kena denda. Wrong, denda. Wrong, denda. Wrong, punishment. Wrong, punishment. Wah. Word by word. But he's slow to anger, abounding in love. And he said, verse 13, as a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion of those who fear him. For he knows how we are formed. The story of the prodigal son also caught into this picture of a fatherhood. If you remember in Luke 15, he got up and went to his father, the son. But while he was still a long way from home, the Bible says, the father saw him, and his father went out to him and ran, not walk, ran and hugged his son and kissed him. Then his son said to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father said to his slave, doesn't even reply to the son. Father, sorry. Orang gaji, mana kamu? Terus dia reply orang gaji. Not even reply to the son. Hurry, bring the best robe and put on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let us eat and celebrate, because this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost, now he's found. So they began to celebrate. Continual confession does not mean that your relationship with God is at risk. One more time. I know it's a bit deep. I also find it deep when I read first time. Just because we confess our sins continually, and we might fall again, and we confess again, and we fall again, it shows to us that it does not mean that your relationship with God is at risk. You are still son. Amen. Even the Israelites fall many times, right? rebel many times, right? Does that, I don't want Israel or Rila, let's go find KK people. Don't want Israel, don't want Israel already. Hey, so many times, hey, cannot tahan that. Wow, cannot. The promise, the covenant until today, it in fact, it's expanded to you and I. That covenant, sealed, until you and I experience it. But continual confession, meaning there's a need for building intimacy. When we confess, it shows to us, hey, you need to build intimacy. You need to stay strong. Just because my son doesn't obey me today, no, I don't want you already. Let me find another son. I forgive. But it shows that we have to work on our what? Intimacy. We need to work on our relationship. There are things that he need to understand, that they need to know. The Father's heart is never settled just because of one sin. God forgive, because God has compassion. It's not even a Christian illustration, but I read this article last Friday. And I'm sure you saw it if you have a what's the in, if Google is Chrome, right? The internet is what? Microsoft is what? Explorer, right? Huh? Edge, Microsoft Edge. Yeah. If you use Microsoft Edge as a web browser, then you will see all this news lah. So somehow this poof, come out in the main page. So I read on. Wow, it's an interesting story of a father's love. Do you encounter that? Okay. Now this there's a story, right? A father of three walk very long distance, right, to go and get makan. The story is like this. I take it from not from myself, it's from the Rakyat Post. So just to make sure it's not mine. So it's in the website lah, in the article. And he chose the brave elements to push into the blemish. He and show love. I show you a picture of a map. Is that a map that, John? So starting from Beranang, Hulu Langat Selangor, this man who don't want to say his name, embark a journey that would test his resolve and showcase his devotion to his family. On one afternoon, he reached out to a shop called Nasi Kukus Kak Cik, a local eatery, inquiring if they had any extra food to spare for his children. Dia minta makanan lah, kalau ada nasi, saya bagi kami. But the shop say, no more already, we close at 4 p.m. But Anita, the father asked if he can come the next day. Can you give? Okay, kalau kau datang besok, we have food for you. Little did they know that this father determination would lead him to set foot from Beranang, to Taman Jasmine Kajang, a considerably distance that would take hours to traverse. That would take about 3 hours walking. He started 7 a.m. As the sun climbed up higher in the sky, the father pressed on, his step driven by unwavering love for his children. When he finally arrived at Nasi Kukus Kak Cik, his clothes were drenched in sweat, a testament of his journey's physical and emotional toll. Basah bajunya. Then the staff, moved by his dedication, learned that the father has lost his source of income due to a broken motorcycle, which would not be repaired until the following week. In the meantime, he had no money to sustain himself, his wife, and his children. Touched by this story, the Nasi Kukus Kak Cik, kudos to them, provided him some essential supplies to help the family buy until his motorcycle was fixed and he could start his new job. Wow. Now, when I read this, almost every father have encountered this kind of scenario. Would you agree? If not you, maybe not yet, but get ready. But as for myself, yes, I have gone through that. We can always, there's some situations in our life when we say, I will do this. I don't mind. Malu-malulah. I will do this. If it requires me to work for 3 hours, I will do it. If it requires me to not to eat this afternoon, I will do it. If it requires me to work extra hours, I will do it. The big question is why a father would do it? What driven him to say, I will do it. I will die. If it takes me my life, I will do it. Amazing, right? I see compassion. I see now when someone or when compassion drives you, if it requires your life, you will do it. If it requires my only and begotten Son to save you, to save humanity, I will do it. I will do it. Drench, walk 3 hours, 4 hours, 10 hours, I will do it. Because I love my Son. I love my family. I love my children. And God loves you. Whatever you think that is so difficult now, He will do it. He will. If it requires God to do sustain or hold His anger to you for 10 more years, He will do it. If you're falling into sins for 100 times already, right? He will do it. He would. Never too late to come to God. Never. There's no perfect time. Or wait lah, until conference, until what is it lah? Evangelistic meeting, then I repent lah. No need to wait. If it requires you for 10 evangelistic meeting to repent, then take your time. He would do it. God would go for that extra mile. And He has compassion. Remembering that and remembering our beloved Father today. As much as we know that the Father that we have today is, we all call our Father the best Father. Which is true. They are the best. They are the best. Because what? Not because they can do everything, but they are Father who care when no one care. They are with you when no one is with you. When you are fatherless, they are with you. They are the Father who give good gifts to you. May not be expensive lah, but it's good. That's the best your Father can give you. In fact, He knows that it's good for you. Well, if He got more money, then He will buy a better one lah. But for now, that's a good one. That's enough. He's also a Father that have great compassion. He's a Father that would go an extra mile for you and I to enjoy the relationship and intimacy with Him. Let's pray. Jesus told us that we can call God our Father. Today, you know that the Lord's Prayer begins with the word, our Father. So now you can pray. Even what you want to pray today, you may think that God never hear your voice. God already know it, even before we ask. But the question is this, are you willing to build that intimacy with Him again? Is calling Him Father as something that not you are not used to? But today, our Heavenly Father, willing to go an extra mile, to say, maybe today is your time. Maybe today you will begin again Maybe today, the sin that you have continued so many times will stop, will be broken, because you begin to build relationship with the Father again. So take your time now. Take your time. I'm going to give you this maybe 1 or 2 minutes. Just ask the Father. Ask, and it will be given you.
Think about His goodness. Think about
sing this as a response and think about God's goodness over your life. Together.
Think about His love. Think about His goodness.
Yes.
Think about His grace that brought us through. For as high as the heavens above, so great is the measure of our Father's love.
Great is the measure.